Good afternoon. I'm here with Rahul Maganti, and he's a freelance journalist based out from Vijayawada, Andhra Pradesh. His primary reporting areas include land rights and displacement in the context of neoliberal economic development. I'm going to ask him a couple of questions on the agenda of Right to Work. Hi Rahul.
Hello.
So my first question to you is, how has the neoliberal economic development of India affected the work culture?
I think it's important to understand that the kind of development, which the kind of narrative which is being portrayed as development, is more like destruction of the pre-capitalist occupations and communities. For example, you'll find that the capital is taking over land, resources like land, forests, and the seaways and the waterways, which are very important resources for the artistic communities, the fisher folk, and the farming communities. So you find that the forest from where the Kondapalli toy makers get their wood is being denotified for a developmental project to build a biodiversity park. You'll also find that the waters, whether that's a Krishna water or whether that's a water in the Bay of Bengal, is being diverted off for industries at the expense of the fisher folk, who now lack any kind of means of livelihood.
Yes.
So it's important to understand how the neoliberal economic development is being played out at various levels of gender and caste, most importantly. Which communities are benefiting, which are the communities which are losing out. So it most often is, the question which should be asked is this: development for whom, development at what cost, and development for whom?
Yes. So these rights, they also affect the artistic community in India, right?
Yes.
So how is it, to what extent is it affected?
So if you, for example, if you look at the way how the state and the capital come together at trying to divert away the resources of the forest, the tribal communities. If you look at the way how technology and mechanization, especially as innovation, in the name of mechanization, in the name of innovation, how it is affected the toy makers, or the power loom, how it affected the kalamkari workers and
yeah.
the handloom workers. You also find that film, TV and film media and movies, how that affected the ways of how that affected the street artists and the puppet artists.
Yeah.
So you find a culture of disposition.
Yes.
Like it's a cultural thing. They have been doing
yeah.
it for
a long time.
Hundreds of years.
Yes.
And you find that there's a cultural disposition happening. Apart from the resources and the
yes.
material disposition, you find the cultural disposition happening. And so if you look at all these ways of how this disposition is happening, that's a way of how capital tries to dismantle the pre-capitalist occupations and try to convert every one of them into workers to serve the capital. But the sad part is that you don't, the same number of people who are being displaced and not being taken into employment by capitalism because of the way how the neoliberal economy functions. So you have 40,000 people being displaced, 40,000 fisher folk being displaced,
yeah.
but you also have only 1,300 jobs being created in that particular project. So,
what are your solutions? I mean, can you give us some solutions to this problem?
Which
can be taken by the government or?
I think laws are not just for people and citizens to follow, it's also for the governments to follow.
Yeah.
So I think most of the illegal work, like the what 90% of what government does is illegal in some
yeah.
sense or the other. It's the government doesn't follow its own laws. For example, you don't follow the PISA Act in the tribal areas, you
yeah.
don't follow the LARR 2013 in places where you're acquiring land. So I think the onus should be on the government to follow the laws, especially, and that's to resist the whole development, which is the whole destruction which is happening in the name of development, I think it's important for the political mobilization also to take place at grassroots, which is a very important thing to do.
So we'll come to the this thing of right to work. So in your opinion, how are collective bargaining and freedom of association important in the context of right to work?
So I think I'll start off from where what I was talking about earlier.
Yeah.
The political narrative is very, very important to win any struggle. Codes are important, but there are certain things which is possible. The legal battle is only an addendum to the political battle.
Mm-hmm.
The movement on the ground is very important, and for you have seen lawyers talking about how they're not willing to take up labor case anymore because of the fact that you win or don't win.
Yeah.
So it's important to understand the class character of the courts and the Indian judiciary, which is why you have also got some progressive judgments when there is a strong movement on ground. And this political movement is possible only when you have certain sense of unionization or certain sense of coming together and forming a union to bargain collectively. But the sad part is that we have had the Modi government trying to dilute the labor laws, and part of this is also trying to put certain restrictions on how a union can be formed. So right now, forming a union in a industry is far, far difficult than what it has been a few decades, couple of decades back before the neoliberal economy started. So it's important to fight for the right to unionize, because which is very important to realize the right of the workers along with the legal battle which you do. So that's the importance of collective bargaining and political narrative and forming a union.
So how would you say that right to work affects the social dialogue of the country as a whole?
So if you look at the way how the resources are being dispossessed of people, whether the tribals or the artistic communities or the fisher folk, you find that there is a certain trend of automation happening, because of which there's a loss of work, loss of livelihood, certain sort of a technology, technological advance, which is rendering a lot of people jobless. So what I think is, there will be a state where you lakhs and lakhs of people will lose their livelihood, while few thousands get the jobs, which is a resultant of this development. And there will be massive inequality in the way how how the development is being done, and it affects the social fabric, and there might be a point where it cannot take it beyond it, and there might be sudden ruptures of class struggles around. But the ruling classes are always clever. They'll try to subvert this and give peanuts back to the people. Possibly one such thing which is being talked about is a universal basic income make sure that the people don't revolt, and so they can give universal basic income as a peanuts to the people while they start plundering the resources even more faster.
Okay, thank you so much for your insight over this topic.
Thank you.